thank you to the sponsor again, and thanks for her hard work and everyone who's been seconded in this budget process. I am very concerned that the process that we have established as a legislative body is so broken, it can only have a bad outcome for taxpayers and for our constituents. We know that, for example, in the 421A negotiations, they weren't conducted by the membership of the state Senate. They weren't conducted in connection with advocates or experts at public hearings. They were done largely, unfortunately, among private parties with the financial interests behind closed doors. And I don't think we can expect, as I said, an outcome that benefits my constituents, particularly as it pertains to rent regulation. And I appreciate the sponsor bringing up statistics from the Rent Guidelines Board. I would think that they are the sworn enemy of some of my colleagues. But the truth is that we have decoupled the conversations around the rent regulations in New York City with the 421A renewal plan, and that has put a lot of our constituents in a significant bind and disadvantage as we continue those discussions forward. I think that we're going to see more and more luxury development as a result of this plan in my district. I think we're going to see more and more luxury rentals. And you know, that might be good for the developers. That's maybe not so good for my district, particularly as it pertains to affordability. And I think there are other programs available. There are programs that we should be more creative about in terms of supporting. I know my colleagues here have a Mitchell Lama renewal plan. We can only look back 50 years to see what senators in this chamber proposed in terms of direct subsidies for affordable housing. It's far more efficient to directly support affordable housing with tax dollars than to provide a tax break for real estate developers who don't build affordable housing. Those developers have no expertise in, or very little expertise in, affordable housing. We should be giving it directly to the developers who do. I have experience in this. I worked for the New York City Housing Partnership in my career, and over the course of two decades, they built over 30,000 units of affordable housing through a direct subsidy program, not through some cockamamie tax break. So, you know, we see again and again in this budget bill, items that have been removed, deleted, modified, and we're not told why. We're not told how. Worse than us not knowing, really, is the public not knowing. So, Mr. President, I think we have a lot of work to do in making certain that while we take strides forward with this budget, of course, in the area of criminal justice, and thank you to my colleagues for their hard work in that regard, I believe that we could do so much better if we opened our process, if we had regular public hearings, if we had time to discuss what was on the table, if we didn't shoehorn the good, the bad, and the ugly in one bill. And we call it the big ugly, but it's become almost an endearing term, and it shouldn't be. There's nothing funny about the fact that we are voting on issues as disparate as raising the age of criminal responsibility, real estate tax breaks, and ending, you know, the possibility for sensible regulations on electronic cigarettes. These are all standalone issues that deserve our time and attention one by one. We shouldn't be forced to vote on an omnibus piece of legislation that has such different policy goals attached to it. Thank you, Mr. President.